When you close your eyes, you may remember when you had wings. How you lifted your mother, how you carried your father on your back. When the fledgling universe was not peppered with land, but covered in oceans of divine tears, before time, before fire, moonlight and daylight, you can almost remember the sweet smell of the evening night. Wind in your feathers, the heft of your loved ones on your back. You can almost remember when they left their bodies mid-flight, before there was land to bury them. You had to bury them in your head. You can almost remember the weight of their memories on your brow, the sound of the ocean, and then in the distance, the rustling of the first tree. You can almost remember that breathless approach and how it felt to finally alight, your first cracked shell, your first heartbreak, how the moon blossomed that first vibrant night.
She boards the train with a paper ticket and a suitcase made of ten.
Ten. The stars are the many eyes of the nine.
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 The passengers drift off to sleep as the train begins to levitate.
Eight. Up the mountain, through the sky, across seven.
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 At night, we find the answers to our questions posted in our mind's wall. Not one. Six.
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 Soon the dead will come to us as they begin to refile.
Five.
Five.
An ear is listening. It hears what was unsaid before.
Four.
The day slips into darkness, and sets itself free.
The moon whispers our names, the clouds too.
Struggle is done.
In the bounty of darkness, I swoon. As a hungry moon courts a forest of indigo clouds. A colorful bird perches in the fog above our heads. A silver egg balanced on its outstretched wing. Glimmering feathers, a glowing shell, the sudden swell of jasmine draped across the budding sky. From the feast of night, the spell is unleashed. A jubilee of mist nestling the leaves.
We used to gather under the bountiful shade of the Ofo tree. We leaned against his generous trunk. What his limbs offered, we cherished. We dressed the wood in iron and held it close. After many years, his verdant banners began to fade. His roots loosened their grip on the earth. The hull of the tree folded in on itself, leaving us to grieve in the harsh sun. When the moon arrived, I had a vision of a tree rustling in the evening sky. I went into the darkness and called out. A voice answered, an onyx chime. Though still in the shadows, he walked with me. He moved with ease among the nightshades. The tree recounted stories about all our kin, and he called us all by name. His dream form carried the heft and voice that his waking one forgot. Through the walk in the garden, we regained what we had lost.
After we lose the sun.
opens another door. After we choose to ride with her, she comes alive once
What? Vision? Came to me when I closed my eyes. Watchful spirits called me to their side. Did they speak? Did my hands ever hold the keys? Did I hear the whistle when they pointed in the dark? Did I feel the clamor? Did the wheels spark? Will I hear who calls for me in the light of day? will I answer? Will I make my train?
That train when you take my hand. Everyone, hello, how are you doing? Welcome. Thank you so much for being here. That was such a beautiful first half, wasn't it? Can we give another round of applause to Mendi and Keith? My name is Curtis Stewart. I am the artistic director of the American Composers Orchestra. Some people like to call me the new Derek, and you know, that's okay. Welcome to our Collaboratory Showcase. Collaboratory is a special program that ACO has created for music that is experimental or rooted in musical traditions not normally associated with orchestral repertoire. We spend time with composers learning about their process, and finding ways that their language and the language of the symphonic orchestra fall together. I'd love to thank our funders. The Fromm Music Foundation is our lead sponsor. The Manis School of Music and the New School is our lead presenting partner. WQXR, our official media partner, TD Charitable Foundation, Rolex Mentor and Protégé Arts Initiative, National Endowment for the Arts, Elizabeth and Justus Schlichting, New York State Council of the Arts with the support of Governor Kathy Hochul and the New York State Legislature. This is one of the culminating concerts of the Sonic Festival, which has been, this is I think day 14 of the Sonic Festival. We've had several concerts here. We've had concerts in Joe's Pub, Roulette, Merkin Hall, all around the city, and it's really been a beautiful chaos the last 2 weeks, and I've been at every concert except for one, unfortunately, and it's just been so inspiring, and I'm also very inspired by these musicians on stage who are constantly available. Before we kick it off, I'd love to welcome Ralph Bumbaka from TD Bank.
Thank you, Curtis. Hello, everyone. June in New York City, festival, Sonic is just extraordinary. I love the way you described it as chaos, but such a beautiful work that we've seen already today, and I'm sure there's more at hand. And at TD and TD Charitable Trust, we look for these opportunities where we can really invest in the communities and make a deep impact. And you saw it on display here today, and you're going to continue to see that. So congratulations to all the young artists in their work, and we wish them well throughout the rest of the year.
Thank you.
Wasn't that incredible? As they're setting up, I'm gonna try to not waste time, but whatever the right word is. Collaboratory addresses systemic barriers within orchestral commissioning. We're kind of like the workshop for the larger orchestras to pick up ideas like this and make it even bigger. We try to generate definition expanding work for the orchestra. So actually, I remember actually seeing Trevor for the first time in Pete's Candy Store. Has anybody been to Pete's Candy Store? And he was using that Keith McMillan pedal. I guess I shouldn't say that out loud because we're on live stream. They're probably going to make us pay money for that. But and I totally stole his idea. It's such a great idea. I'm doing it at such a minimal level. So I just think what he's up to is so genius. The next person that's about to play, Marcus Gilmore, and I went to high school together at LaGuardia Performing Arts High School. We were in homeroom together, actually. And we would make him do polyrhythms like 7 against 11, and he would just do it. I'm so excited to see this. Basically, the way Collaboratory works is we workshop with the composers in multiple sessions throughout the year, developing smaller sections and figuring out just the technical elements of everything. And so they really get the time with an orchestra that you may not normally get when you're in your professional studies, in your professional work, when you have to come in and hit with 3 rehearsals. We're gonna get to more of that in the Q&A, but I'd like to welcome Marcus Gilmore to the stage.
When our laughter skids across the floor like beads yanked from some girl's throat, what waits where the laughter gathers? And later, when our saw-toothed breaths lay us down on a bed of leaves, what feeds with ceaseless focus on the leaves? It's solid, yet permeable, like a mood. Like God, it has no face. Like lust, it flickers on without a prick of guilt. We move in and out of rooms, leaving our dust, our voices pooled on sills. We hurry from door to door in a downpour of days. Old trees inch up, their trunks thick with new rings. All that we see grows into the ground, and all we live blind to leans its deathless heft to our ears and sings. The everlasting self comes in from a downpour, shaking water in every direction, a collaborative condition, gathered, shed, spread, then forgotten, reabsorbed, like love from a lifetime ago, and mud a dog has tracked across the floor.
One more time for Marcus Gilmore. We have a very, very special treat today. This is again me, you know, making time happen while you're still sitting here. Zakir Hussain is here to play with Marcus. We're gonna get him all set up here. Zakir was Marcus's mentor through the Rolex Foundation for this project. And I'd like to welcome Rebecca Irvin from Rolex to speak a little bit about their program.
Thank you, Curtis, and good evening, everyone. As he said, my name is Rebecca Irvin, and I'm the director of the Rolex Mentor and Protégé Arts Initiative in Geneva, Switzerland. Congratulations, Marcus, and also Trevor, Mendi, and Keith for this wonderful work. So the work that you just heard was actually the US premiere of Pulse, and this was a work that Marcus composed in very large part during his mentorship with Zakir Hussain, the great tabla maestro. And Marcus was the protege in music in the 2018-2019 Rolex Arts Initiative. And this program pairs, it's been around for 20 years. We just celebrated our 20th anniversary in Athens last month. It was launched in 2002. And it's a program that every 2 years invites great senior artists to take on a young professional for the period of a creative, extended period of creative collaboration. And it's not only works in music, but also we organize mentorships in dance, theater, literature, visual arts, architecture, and film. And in each of these areas, the mentors actually not only share their craft, but also their creative process, how they organize, how they live their lives. And I know in this particular case, Zakir, who's also written concertos for tabla, helped Marcus in this creative process. And Tracy K. Smith, who wrote and read the spoken word that you heard during the piece, was also a protege in our program. She worked with the great late Hans Magnus Enzensberger, and she's a poet and was for several years the Poet Laureate of the United States, which is wonderful. And I also have to acknowledge the American Composers Orchestra, because we started working with them several years ago when Ed Lim, who is here in the audience, was actually the CEO. And we did a project together around Philip Glass, who was a former mentor, and worked with Pauchi Sasaki, and that was a great great opportunity. And when Zakir and Marcus started working together, and Marcus wanted to compose a work for orchestra, we decided to partner with the American Composers Orchestra to help make this happen, and thank you for that. As you see, I'm trying to fill in as Curtis was doing. But the work that you saw tonight, this is a new version of it. The first, the world premiere took place in South Africa in Cape Town with the Cape Town Philharmonic in February 2020. And we had intended a few months later to come with the ACO and do the premiere here of the US. And of course that didn't happen. So after the pandemic and everything else, we're finally really thrilled to be here 3 years later to be showing you this work. So I'd like to also congratulate all the participants tonight, and particularly I think the conductor, David Bloom, probably needs a hand too, right? And I want to thank very much Melissa Ngan, who's the current president and CEO, and Lindsay Working from the ACO, who helped us make this concert possible tonight. So I think they're almost done. And I just want to thank very much Tracy Smith from coming down from Boston, and Zakir Hussain, who's come in especially for this event from San Francisco. He's based between the West Coast and Mumbai. And this, you're in for a real treat, because when we knew that Zakir was coming, we said, well, would you like to play with Marcus? And I think what you're going to hear, the two of them together, to the world, some of the world's great percussionists improvising together, I think you're in for a treat. So, are you ready? Not quite ready. Curtis, I think you want to fill in a little bit more. I think I've done more than my share. Thank you.
Oops. Thank you so much. And I'm sorry for moving the mic while you were speaking. That's inappropriate. It's been really amazing, actually, watching these pieces come together, especially Mendi and Keith's piece, which has so much, there's so much of a technical element. And it was all so simply done. It felt very, not simplistic, but simple and well taken. So I'm just glad it went well. Does anybody have questions? Yeah. That's interesting. How are the sounds of nature and the sensibility of that translated into music? Well, it's kind of funny asking that question in a room like this, in a way, which I think about that a lot, especially being a New Yorker and thinking about actually not just the collaboration, but the intersection and interruption of nature that we're dealing with all the time. So for me, the elements of I think I want to let the composers speak to that. But as I'm interpreting that, the technology mixed with the music and the acoustic instruments kind of hits that. How are we doing with tech? We're good. Phew. Enjoy.
No pressure, Zakir, no pressure. Doesn't work. What an amazing evening, huh? So far, it's just fantastic. Ta-da. What are we going to do? You need to fix something or that happened? That's what the Beatles were talking about, Maxwell's. For sale. Thank you.
Thank you all so much for coming. We're going to have a little Q&A now, if you'd like to stay or not. Thank you for coming, and have a great day. I'd like to invite all the composers and all the collaborators up for our Q&A. Okay. I really want to get these brilliant people out and about so they can talk to you, because I can feel the energy in the room, and so it doesn't feel like Q&A energy right now.
It
feels more like celebratory, and I just want to thank you guys all so much. Can we all thank our creators?
Hey, we should also thank Rebecca up there.
And Rebecca and our partners.
Rebecca, the sound person.
Rolex,
the
TV.
Yes, Rebecca, the sound person. Could you put everybody in the monitor, please, Rebecca?
So this project between Collaboratory... Between Collaboratory and Rolex's Mentor Protégé Arts Initiative kind of questions the nature of mentorship. I think for all of us, we probably have been mentored. We are mentors. We take the torch, we pass it, and we take the energy as well. I was just wondering, what does mentorship look like for all of you, and all of you in the audience and all the people watching? What does mentorship look like? Maybe we can start with Marcus. What was some of the process? what did the mentorship process look like for you, or in general, or being a mentor?
I've been extremely fortunate to be in situations where I've been mentored, you know, different points in my life, and at this point, I guess you could say I've mentored other people for sure, but. Since we're here, I guess I'll talk about this particular mentorship. And the whole thing started, I guess, 2018? 2017 is when the process started, yeah. With this mentorship, it was pretty deep because it was so clear that it was something that was supposed to happen, because there was this program, the Arts Initiative, that I was invited to apply to, and so I thought it would be a great opportunity. But at the same time, there were outside forces that were trying to get us together as well. Mm. So it was kind of like it was pretty clear that it was supposed to happen, at least for me. But, you know, I still went through the whole process and everything. You know, there was a process in terms of the Rolex thing, but outside of that, you know, I was getting clear indications to and invited to collaborate with him. And so once that started, you know, basically for me, I guess, I just like to spend time around people, you know? It's pretty simple. We can really talk about anything. Of course, I have questions, but just being around the person is so beneficial in so many ways. Like, it's kind of hard to articulate. Mm. Sometimes people think it's only about getting specific information, but for me, it's really the whole thing. So.
Right. Being the person in the room. Is,
oh yeah, that's it. Yeah, yeah. That's what it's always been for me. So
yeah, Zakir, do you have a reaction to that, or what does mentorship look like for you with this process? Did you guys have to travel, or how did you? I mean, you guys are very busy people. How did you find each other?
Well, for me, I wanted to learn more, and this guy seemed like the person to go to, and so that's what it is. I mean, any kind of mentor or protege ship is a two-way street. I mean, we both learn how to interact and how to share information with each other, and how to, you know, shore up each other's confidence and abilities and so on and so forth. And as a child, I mean, I learned from my dad, and that and his ideas of rhythms and stuff came into my ears from the time when I was 3 days old. He would hold me in his arm and sing rhythms. And so that DNA and that ideas, those thoughts were already kind of confused in here. And there are many landmark moments in my life where there have been super beings, spirits, musicians, artists, who have helped me sort things out. So here was this kindred spirit right there, and similar DNA, his grandfather, the great Mr. Roy Haynes, and that information from, I guess, in his blood cells and since he was a baby. So it seemed like we were walking a parallel path, and we just needed to reach out and touch each other's tracks,
yes,
and just absorb. And Rolex made that possible.
Yes.
And so here we are, and it has been that way. And I have a feeling that I've learned more from hanging out with him, especially to figure out how not to dress for the concert. Look at those shoes, man.
That's great.
Those are some kicks. What's going on here? I just got simple Indian stuff. No, but really, it really has been very special, and I cannot imagine my good fortune that we came across each other.
That's beautiful. I think that's probably the sign of a really great, I hate to use the word teacher because we think of it as a one-way street, but that's the sign of a really great, that person in the room where it is two-way. And
there's no teacher.
Right, I'd like to think of it in terms of our orchestral works and composers. It is two ways. The composers affect the orchestra just as much as the orchestra affects the composers. Actually, speaking of bloodstream, I noticed the heart in your work, Trevor, and I just wanted to touch on Cohere touch and just the concept of it and how it extends into this idea of mentorship.
Yeah, the core concept that I sort of worked off of was that we are always connected no matter what is going on. Even if we think that we're by ourselves, in some way we're always with other people, like in a lot of ways. And there's a tangible way of looking at that is you can take your smartphone and call somebody, right? Or in this case, that same technology that you use for that can be used to create a piece. And in some cases, that is what was being used tonight with some of the musicians who were coming in from different time zones and in a lot of different, I guess, like data streams. So that network was like a heart, a seed, this thing that can spread through anything.
That's amazing. I imagine that technology was developed. Did you start that during the pandemic, or were you doing that before, or how?
So a little bit of both. Before, it was, I would say, I was operating on a local network, so I would create delays of my own sound and try to affect the sound around me. And then, of course, with the pandemic, we were reaching out and trying to do that in a broader sense. And the thing that I found is the reaction that I might get in a room where I have like an echo is, in terms of timing, is very similar to what I would get with a person, except they'll change that message and send it back in a different way. And it was this sort of, kind of this funny interplay, for me mentally as a musician, is like, there's this mechanism, and then it's like, whoa, I'm getting this thing from this person, and then mixing those things together, and like, what does that sound do, and can that sound be that way in that location, and in another way in my location, or in this case, in eight locations, having the same piece played, sounding different, and it's still meaning something very, very deep for each person. Very late in some of the locations where everybody was coming in, so I think part of that dedication comes from experiencing that very deeply. I've become very close with everybody that we just saw on the screen.
Finding ways to be together even when we're apart. Actually, can you just do you remember all the places or just some of the more fun ones?
Yeah, there's Argentina, Uganda, Calcutta in India, Florida, upstate New York, Washington, D.C., Los Angeles. I have a collaborator in Korea also who wasn't able to make it for this time, but there's kind of this growing network, I feel like, of musicians who are learning how to do this. And there's a lot that can be learned from and expanded within this sort of, it's like a new format based on the current format, not instead of, but with.
Mm-hmm. And how does, you're working on some educational programs with this piece. Is there, how does that fit into the mentorship portion of how you see yourself as a mentor?
I think it's actually, I feel like it's very interesting is you can have this tactile experience from anywhere in the world, as long as you know I'm able to get a video feed from you and some sound, and you can shape what the entire orchestra sounds like. You can shape what my sound sounds like. You can go like this, and then it does something else for every single person that's watching, essentially affecting every single thing, even if you're in your room by yourself. When I was trying to design this system, I found that idea to be kind of astounding. It's like, that doesn't make any sense. Let's see, like, can that happen? And it's like, I think so. And kind of here we are. And I think I'm still digesting what we just did. And I think that there's so many implications, especially if you think of that as a new space. Like when we do that, that there are, it's like being in a new kind of room, alternate musical dimension, and there's different rules, but there are rules that work, and you can predictably do things. What does that mean? What kind of things can we create that are happening all over the place? So.
Yeah, it's great to see you bringing that with you all over the place. Speaking of how music affects us and how we take things from different vantage points and we feel from our own perspective, Mendi and Keith, you guys have a very specific perspective about what the intent of your music making and the performance. Do you want to speak a little bit on the intent with DreamTrain?
Yes, so I'll begin with the idea of the DreamTrain, which for us is about kind of narratively, it's about a train that goes to the sky so you can dream with others. But for us, music is a ship, you know, and it's a location. And so that is a transportation element. And then when we started really researching other musical and poetic and artistic broadly, things that were related, we really landed on this idea of journeying things. And we became really focused on the fact that through our dreams we communicate with spirits. And so that became a really important part of what the structure became.
Yeah, I'll say a little bit about the form. I mean, tonight we're kind of presenting this project in a sort of concert presentation, but the form of this is really an installation, and so the video and sound sort of operates perpetually, and then there's, you know, a live component of it that happens at specific times. And so most of our projects are sound installations. That is how we work. But, you know, I wanted to go for a second back to this idea of mentorship that you talked about, because I was thinking about, you know, what we got out of this collaboratory process. And for us, a lot of this was, I mean, I guess the way we think about mentorship is really just dialogue, is really kind of a focused dialogue. And in this process, you know, we both work with sort of longtime collaborators like Paloma McGregor, who directed this thing and did the movement, and our friend Keith Witte, who did orchestration for this. So we've had a dialogue with people that we've been working with for like more than a decade, but then, you know, also had a student working with lighting. And so having dialogue with like old friends and students, I guess that's how we think of mentorship. And that's kind of what our process was like, sort of working with musicians in the orchestra and sort of learning to communicate to the orchestra and learning to work with David, who conducted, and so yes, yeah, just a focused dialogue.
And from our side, it's dialogue as well, learning how to hear and listen, and figure out how we can create a structure for you to realize at least part of your vision, yeah, if not the full effect. And I can't wait to see it in a fully installed We were talking about all different kinds of versions of this piece, where the audience would be in one room and the orchestra would be in another room, and or where we could surround you in video. So I can't wait for that day, but we'll see that one too. How does dialogue fit with you guys, Marcus and Zakir? Do you communicate? Do you find that you talk about what you're doing and then play, or do you just sit down and play, or is that, how does that?
It's a combination. Mm-hmm. In terms of when we play together, there are certain things that are discussed and certain things, most things that are not, really, unless they're discussed, you know, linguistically through the drums, you know? So, that's the connection, you know, the common thread, not just musicians, but like percussionists and drummers, is, you know, it's a really ancient tradition in many cultures. And particularly from Zakir's culture, it's ancient and it's like very traceable how far it goes, really. And it's also very linguistic, you know what I mean, like tonally. So that's one of the things I really love about it.
Yeah, it's amazing to see that in real time. I mean.
Yeah. And the advantage for us, I mean, I guess the fortunate thing is that we are both rhythm players, so there is a certain, you know, language similarity that is there for us, and words, as in regular words we speak through, at times are not even needed. In fact, better if not, and work through these core organic ether information and pass it on, and it works. And that's basically what we've done. I mean, I'd be doing my workshop and Maestro would be in the corner sitting there, and he'd just be there and listening. Next thing I know, he's actually doing that. And I said, well, he didn't write anything. He didn't record anything. At least I didn't see that. And so how is it that this is happening? And it's transposed already. It is already in place. And so that is something that the power of ancient language that does not need mere words to be able to make that connection. And in this case, not necessarily.
It's beautiful. It was also beautiful how those rhythms were permeating into our orchestra. And we were talking about this, having certain players listen to various members of the percussion section and just allowing the rhythm to affect us in ways that notation can't describe. And so I just feel honored that you guys, you know, made that artifact for it to affect us in the orchestral world. I think that's really beautiful. So in terms of this particular piece, did you play together? Did you talk about it? What was the process of that?
It's collection? Basically, Mr. Gilmore had this idea in place. And my job was to, you know, just kind of, by all means, and no, not at all, or whatever. It's basically that, and it was mostly always by all means, yes, of course,
right.
And so it's just a matter of someone having certain abilities, and it's ingrained, it's inborn, it's there all the time, but just needs a little confirmation that yes, but this is legit and this is valid,
right.
and don't be shy and don't hesitate and don't worry and it's okay if you fail, and
right.
Don't be afraid to fail and don't be threatened, all that kind of stuff, as opposed to this chord works here or
right.
or this note works there, or you know, so that is something that's already in place.
That confirmation and sense of legitimacy, internal, is deep.
It's really deep. It's paramount.
Did you guys have a moment where you wondered, for anybody, this is for everybody, where, like, can I do this? Did you have a moment where you were like, I don't know if I'm, can this happen, or do I do this, or how does this fit?
I may have, yeah. I may have had a few times with that. I mean, a simple thing of, you know, maybe dealing with internet, but then also, I guess, compositionally exploring what happens when we do different things in different timings. Like in within my piece, like it's in a practical sense, the way it's written, it allows everybody to figure out how to play in time together without having to think about it too much. And, you know, instead of dealing with numbers, it's like accessing your musical skills and your musical sense. And there were, I mean, I would say there are a number of times where, especially as I got further away from where I was, and then just simple technical things, kind of figuring out how to overcome that. How do you bring somebody back in if they fall off a little bit? And I'd say too, like with classes that I've taught in this medium where it's, I'm in one place with one class and with another, over time, everybody figures it out. It just happens very naturally. In some cases, not talking about it as much, but just kind of doing it can be a really powerful thing. Having, you know, musicians discover their way of doing it within that within the form of the piece. Mm. That was definitely a big challenge for me.
So the piece itself caused you to continue. In a way, yeah. By doing it, and finding your way back, the piece itself causes you to continue.
Exactly.
That's interesting. Did you guys?
I think we're often working in new territory, working with new territory and new tools, and so I think we have a way of bringing ourselves and what we do into new contexts. So you know the. Finding out what is going to be the thing that that is the constraint, I think, is always part of the process. So we know it's going to happen, it does happen, and then we have to adjust. But I think what we do in that moment is remind ourselves that we know how to find the constraints and work with them.
Yeah, I mean, the kind of spaces we work in, we're very comfortable not knowing things, right? Like that's our muscle. yeah, and as I said before, we have our longtime collaborators with us, so they're our sounding board, and our mothers. Our mothers are here.
yes, my mother is turning 86 today. This is her 86th birthday.
yes, happy birthday. And so, you know, our mothers are not artists, but extremely honest people. And so that helps.
Okay, there you go.
Well, we have to, this feels like we were just on the precipice of getting deep there, especially when we started talking about mamas. But we have to wrap. Do you have any things anybody want? Last words, any thoughts?
I'll just say thank you for this process. Yeah, this has been a really good process.
Thank you. Yep.
Yeah, thank you.
Can we give it to Trevor New, Mendi and Keith Obadike, Marcus Gilmore, Zakir Hussain. Thank you.